In this video, we delve deeper into the dark and murky realm of information warfare. This modern form of warfare is devious and cunning, and one of its most powerful tools is the red herring. In our previous videos, we have explored the Hegelian dialectic and red flag operations, but now we turn our attention to another treacherous tactic, the red herring. As we live in a world where information overload is the norm, it is all too easy to get sidetracked by seemingly relevant details that have nothing to do with the fundamental issue at hand. This is where the distraction of the red herring comes into play. A red herring is a trick used to divert people's attention away from the real problem or topic at hand. It is a deliberate attempt to deceive people by providing them with irrelevant information that has the potential to either confuse or distract them from the main issue. The term red herring comes from the practice of using fish with strong smells to distract hunting dogs from their real target. Imagine trying to solve a complex mathematical problem, and someone keeps bombarding you with irrelevant information. It would be incredibly difficult to find the correct answer. The same thing happens in the world of information warfare. Unscrupulous individuals use red herring tactics to distract us, divert our attention to irrelevant details, and ultimately further their own agendas. One of the most common types of red herring is the ad hominem fallacy. This involves attacking someone's character or personal traits instead of addressing the real issue. Politicians often use this tactic to discredit their opponents by focusing on their personal lives or character flaws. Ad hominem attacks can be extremely effective because they appeal to people's emotions rather than their logic, making it difficult to counter them with rational arguments. Another type of red herring is the straw man fallacy. This is when someone misrepresents their opponent's argument or position to make it easier to attack. This strategy is often used in debates and discussions to give a false impression of an opponent's point of view, making it easier to discredit. By attacking a distorted version of an opponent's argument, red herring can take the focus off the real issue and make it challenging to have a productive conversation. But how are red herrings used in information warfare? Well, in information warfare, red herring works by spreading false or misleading information that distracts people's attention from the main issue or topic being discussed. This tactic creates confusion and doubt, making it difficult for people to discern the truth from lies. Red herring creates a smokescreen that covers up the real issue or topic by presenting irrelevant or inaccurate information. By planting seeds of doubt, creating uncertainty, and ultimately undermining the opposing party's credibility, the use of red herrings can be an effective strategy. Red herring can be used in different kinds of information warfare, like propaganda, disinformation, and cyber warfare. In the realm of propaganda, the term red herring is used to manipulate public opinion by diverting attention away from the truth. This tactic is often used by those who seek to hide their true intentions and deceive the masses. In the realm of disinformation, the red herring is used to spread false information to tarnish the reputation of the opposing side. This technique is a favorite of those who seek to undermine their enemies by spreading lies and half-truths. And in the realm of cyber warfare, the red herring is used to deceive the target system by leading it in the wrong direction. This is often achieved through the use of decoys, false flags, and misleading data. One example of the red herring in action is the use of false accusations or allegations. In the lead-up to the Iraq War, the U.S. government claimed that Saddam Hussein possessed weapons of mass destruction, even though there was absolutely no evidence that this was actually true. This lie was used to justify the invasion of Iraq and to hide the real reasons for the war. Another example of the red herring is the use of decoys or false flags. Cyber attackers frequently use decoy systems or false flags in cyber warfare to make the target system believe that something else is happening. In the Stuxnet attack on Iranian nuclear facilities, for example, the attackers used a fake system to make the operators believe that everything was normal while the actual attack was taking place. The impact of the red herring on the information ecosystem can be significant. When bad actors spread false or misleading information, it can cause confusion and uncertainty among those who receive it. This can lead to a decrease in public confidence in institutions, which can, in turn, impact policymaking. In the worst-case scenario, the red herring can lead to conflict, as was the case before the Iraq War. Now, let us now examine how the red herring has been used in different wars and conflicts throughout history. One notable example is how propaganda was used during World War II. Both the Axis and the Allies used the red herring tactic to influence public opinion and distract from the real goals of the war. The Nazis, in particular, developed a notorious reputation for their extensive use of propaganda. They used posters, movies, and speeches to promote their fascist ideas, which caused the German people to believe that they were better than everyone else. The Nazis presented themselves as protectors of the Aryan race, while convincing the Germans that Jews, homosexuals, and other marginalized groups were less than human and deserved to be killed. Similar to how government and media portrayed so-called anti-vaxxers during the recent global pandemic. One of the most infamous pieces of Nazi propaganda was the film The Eternal Jew. This film depicted Jews as parasites and vermin who were responsible for society's degradation. It included horrific images of Jews and spread false rumors about their supposed greed and immorality. The purpose of this film was to dehumanize Jews and justify their mass murder during the Holocaust, which resulted in the deaths of 6 million Jews. On the side of the Allies, propaganda was also used to garner support for the war effort. In the U.S., posters were created to encourage citizens to buy war bonds and conserve resources. These posters often featured patriotic slogans and images of troops or war heroes intended to create a sense of pride and unity in the country. One of the Allies' most successful pieces of propaganda was the poster that read, "We can do it." The poster featured a strong, determined woman flexing her muscles, and the slogan, "We can do it," was written in gigantic letters. Its purpose was to encourage women to take up jobs that were traditionally done by men so that they could support the war effort. Since then, it has become an iconic symbol of the empowerment of women and is widely used to represent the feminist movement. As you can see, the red herring tactic is a clever strategy that is used to deceive and mislead people. Now let us look at some historical examples. During the Gulf of Tonkin incident, the U.S. government lied to the entire world when it claimed that North Vietnamese forces had attacked U.S. naval ships in the Gulf of Tonkin. This lie was used to explain why the U.S. was involved in the Vietnam War and to hide the real reasons for the war. During the Cold War, both the U.S. and the Soviet Union used red herring to discredit each other. The U.S. used propaganda to portray the Soviet Union as a cruel and oppressive government, while the Soviet Union used propaganda to depict the U.S. as a capitalist and imperialist country. In the early 1950s, the U.S. government used a red herring to distract people from their nuclear testing activities. They claimed that a series of UFO sightings was evidence of extraterrestrial life, when in fact, it was a lie. They just wanted to draw people's attention away from their nuclear testing. In 1967, Israel used a red herring to deceive the Arab states during the Six-Day War. Here's what happened. The Israelis wanted the conflict to end quickly, so they spread false rumors that they were going to invade Syria, which caused the Arab troops to shift their focus away from the Sinai Peninsula. This lie, this red herring, allowed Israel to win the war in just 6 days. During the Watergate scandal in the 1970s, the Nixon administration used a red herring to hide their own wrongdoing. They claimed that the leak of classified information to the press was the real problem, not the break-in at the Watergate Hotel. This lie allowed them to divert attention from the crimes they were actually committing. These examples from history show how red herring can affect the outcome of conflicts. False or misleading information can cause confusion, uncertainty, and damage trust. This can ultimately impact how decisions are made. Now, you may be wondering, how can we detect and stop red herring? In information warfare, it can be challenging to identify and prevent red herring because it involves sifting through a large amount of information to find false or misleading claims. However, there are ways to detect red herring, such as fact-checking, checking the credibility of the source providing the information, and understanding how to use the media effectively. Fact-checking involves ensuring that the information is accurate and based on reliable sources and research. This can help identify false or misleading claims and prevent them from spreading. Verifying the source credibility involves assessing the reliability of the source to ensure that the information is fair and accurate. It is imperative that we learn to think critically and recognize the false and misleading claims that are often used to manipulate us in information warfare. The media, which should be a source of truth, are unfortunately notorious for spreading lies and misinformation. To combat red herring in information warfare, we must promote the use of reliable sources and stop the spread of false information. We must encourage open dialogue and debate to ensure that our sources of information are open, accountable, and honest. Furthermore, we must hold individuals and organizations accountable for their use of red herring tactics. We must call out those who use these tactics and hold them to a high standard of openness and personal accountability. It is up to each of us to educate ourselves on the tactics of red herring and how they influence the ecosystem of knowledge. By doing so, we can create a more open and trustworthy information ecosystem. However, we must be vigilant because powerful forces are working to keep us uneducated and detached from what is happening in the world. We must question everything and look for the truth. And finally, I want you to stay safe and be cautious. Get the facts, know what is happening, and always look for the truth. In the next video, we will look at another information warfare tactic, limited hangout. Thank you for watching.